they would sort of the rat, and at 11 months old, what they would do to the babies, behind the baby's back, they'd get like a hammer and go bang. Remember, this you wouldn't pass this now, it's a clinical trial, so don't do this at home. But they'd do like a big bang, and eventually what the baby would do is it became afraid or fear of not just a white rat, a tame white rat, but anything that looks similar. Okay, my understanding is that they did not, they couldn't find. I think the idea was sort of unconditional response, but I don't think they could track little Albert, which is a pseudonym down again. No one knows what happened to the baby. There was all sorts of, you know, rumors, whatever. And the reason I bring that up is that, okay, so we can have an implicit reaction. So I think about the brain in one respect where we function automatically. So let's say, for example, you experience a situation, and that could be in a plane, it could be in a car, it could be someone, say, for example, let's say someone is fought in a war, and at the point of experience some sort of trauma, they hear a plane go over their head, and then they hear a plane again, but in a safe environment, how do they might react in that situation? It could ring the alarm bell, okay? So there is that to take in consideration. Also, bearing in mind that we learn from observation too. I don't know if you've heard of the Bobo doll experiments by Bandura, and what they would do, cutting a long story short, they'd take three groups of young people and that expose them to adults behaving in a certain way to the dolls. So some were being aggressive. Some of the group were exposed to adults being loving to the doll, and some were exposed to the group neutral. So what they did find is that the group exposure impacted the children's reaction. Now that's cutting a long story short. There's research papers out there, you can read the article. But observational learning. So we learn from observation. So point being, if you sort of grew up in a country where spiders were dangerous, and you saw your parents jump 6 feet in the air when they saw a spider, do you think you would react differently to someone who's brought up in the country that sort of saw their parents pick the spider up in the hand? And it's that observational learning. We learn through observation as well as. So from the point of view of fear response, you can change your behavior, how you react to certain events and information that's constantly coming in. Okay? And one of the ways to do that, and one thing to take into consideration, is that memories gradually fade. Okay, so memories are from states from a gone by time. So let's say you went on holiday last year. The following day from your vacation, you come back. Cognitively, you're going to be able to remember a lot more than you remember now, because it's going to start to fade. But equally, had you have an experience on the holiday, say if you have a car accident or you have a breakup, the emotion is as raw or as intense as what it was then. Now, potentially, if you start focusing on it, if you have the same appraisal. So the imagined memory fades away because the brain only has finite neurons that we use for other memories as we go along. Now, hence being experiential in what we do is quite useful. But from one point of view too is our appraisal. So initially we might interpret a situation in a certain way and that has a certain reaction. So the little Albert pseudonym, when he first sees the white rat as sort of tame and fluffy and gentle, his reappraisal then is different to what it was initially, because he hears the loud noise, bang. Okay. Equally, the children who see the adults play with the dolls in an aggressive way or in a useful in a positive way, in a neutral way, that impacts their appraisal of that situation. So when you think about it this way, and look at it this way, let's say you got made redundant 10 years ago, and it was a difficult experience for you, and you hear again they're making redundancies in your workplace. The experience that you had all those years ago is going to affect the way you feel about what's coming up now. To a certain extent, but equally your appraisal on the situation coming up. So if someone's being made redundant, their appraisal might be negative, neutral, positive. It could be, I won't have money to pay the bills, I'll end up living on the street, and so on and so forth. Their thoughts around the situation are going to impact their behavior, the emotion, their behavior, the physiology. Equally, one might be more neutral. Lost a job before, I picked another one up. The same applies. So emotionally, I might feel a bit more neutral. Behavior, I might just do a CV and be proactive. The physical implication is they sort of go about their business. They are okay to carry out tasks. Whereas the first instance, there might be social avoidance. They don't apply. But equally, the other person might be, they might be more excited. Well, you know, the dawn of a new beginning. And that one chapter closes. So it's all relative to people's circumstances, by the way. But equally, you can see that a certain situation. So, for example, if you're driving in a car and you get cut up by another car, there's a very good chance you might personalize it and roll down the window and start giving it, as people do, I'm sure you've done, we've all done before. You're not thinking at that point, are they racing their wife to hospital to have a baby? Okay, we're not logically thinking. Or if you get a strong wind blows the car, you don't start arguing with the wind, do you? Damn you, wind, you start, you know? Okay, so appraisal's different, which is useful from that point of view, because you can reappraise a situation that's not as dangerous as originally was appraised to be and reduce the set of fear responses. Okay, so it's in your reappraisal of the situation. I've mentioned this before, I'll mention it again. At lunchtime, you go for a walk and you see your friend walking down the street. You had a mild fallout a week before. You see him again and they walk straight past you. Your appraisal might be, have they fallen out? Are they not talking to me? Okay, and then you get overwhelmed, upset, and that response behavior, you might be escaping text, or you might not bother contact them again. I'll ignore that person, okay? Because emotionally feel overwhelmed and angry and sad. But equally, you could reappraise situation, and it might be, you know what? They could have been preoccupied. They may not have seen you. They might have something else in their mind. And you're going to feel differently if that's the way you see the situation, because that could be the case. We don't know. And then you might send a text, are you okay? Is everything okay? Did you see me? And they could turn around and say, yeah, I did see you, I ignored you, so I don't want. But then you can't control that. There's a very good chance they won't do that. Okay? So let's give you an idea, and we'll sort of go into more detail, and we'll do other techniques and interventions throughout the course. Sometimes people behave like 5-year-olds. Something happened with them very early on in their life, and the same emotion impacts their behavior. So when I was doing the session years ago on BBC Radio Manchester with the woman who had the fear of swimming, but her goal wasn't to go swimming. Her goal was to reduce weight, but we felt if she would get swimming again, she could get social again. She's 64 years of age, and not swimming since 8 years of age, because she's sort of built a fear response to swimming pool based on the experience. So for 56 years, she's not gone back in pool, but we feel that could be a mechanism to be more social, just with friends and book a holiday. That could be a catalyst, okay? So really emotionally, to a certain extent, she still feels the same way. Go anywhere near a swimming pool, based on what happened then, even though it's 56 years later, she still feels the same way. And that's impacting her behavior. She's avoiding it. Because we want to avoid danger, don't we? Survival. Emotions are there to serve you, protect you. We want to avoid danger or perceived danger. And that danger might not be real. What is real, what's not real? Okay? But equally, when I did the timeline and regression with her and did a reappraisal, it helped to amalgamate and separate, I should say, the emotion, behavior, the physiological response, the beliefs around the situation, and reappraise the situation in a different way, reassociate. So really she was carrying fear, piggybacking fear. So it's like giving someone a piggyback. She's piggybacking fear. But what we can do is let the fear come off, dissociate from it, and piggyback a new association to swimming, which is like friends and a good time and fun. So one component of the hypnotic phenomena, which we talk about in the course, is dissociation. What are you associating to? And what are you disassociating from? So when you get furious, you've been cut up on the road, you go into like a state. You're in a state, okay? And you're furious and it impacts your behavior. Okay, you're in that state. And you can break that state to be in a more resourceful state, which will impact your behavior as well. So where the person I was working with, where Margaret's concerned, the reappraisal, the association, disassociation, would be one of the ways that we would utilize to help her go back again. Okay, and she would end up going swimming again comfortably. And all this happened over the space of about a 1 hour session. And I'm not suggesting and implying that that's going to happen for everybody, because each case is independent to its own formulation. But equally in saying that, it goes to show that you could be flying in a plane and hit turbulence, and then you have an association to flying and the behavior avoid flying again. But equally, why should it take a long time to overcome it? We don't really need to be psychoanalytical. We can look for ways to look forward. That's not to say that it's going to work for everybody in a short time, because we know with many, many things, there's various reasons. It's all multifactorial. We want to be holistic and take into consideration, you know, biology, genetic, psychology, cognitively, social factors. You take all these things into consideration, uncover every stone, in addition to being reductionist and say, okay, that's causing that. Because a lot of things are multifactorial, aren't they, really, in that respect. So from this point of view, we can sort of hold that thought for now, and we'll look at the brain a little bit here. And we'll sort of look at the limbic system. And one of the things I do when I work with clients who are in high pressure situations and they've got to answer questions at a quick speed. So whenever I've done some work with, say, football managers, for example, who are being press interviewed, one of the things I say to the football manager, before you answer the question, to get a more logical response, then just take a sip of water, not vodka, not whiskey, because that buys you 6 seconds, okay, to push it to a more logical response, okay, a more logical response, a clearer response. And one of the reasons for that is because if the manager gets riled up and wound up, what impact do you think it can have on the players? We see the manager getting all wound up. It could have a negative impact on players because they see the manager getting wound up. Observational learning, see the manager get riled up, not calm, it's going to affect them, one would think, especially if the role identity of the manager is this sort of, maybe not paternal figure, but leadership figure. You're going to battle, the leaders are imminent. The cultural leaders that we talked a lot about in sport, who would lead a team, the big personalities, in any environment, are key, who stand up. And if they start to struggle, the rest of the team fall like a stack of dominoes. Okay, so that 6 second response to push it to the neocortex, a logical response. That's not to say that in certain situations that the cortisol doesn't flood the body for a few hours, and you know, but to say that we can move logical. And I did the same with telesales people. If you get riled up, take a breather. Before you go to the next call, just take a time out. More logical. You get a text or an email and it sort of doesn't fit into your framework and it riles you up a little bit, it might be best not to reply straight away. Just park the bus and come back to it when you're more logical, clearer. Okay? Because all you're going to do really is feed the limbic system of the other person, and you're going to feed your own primal, or one of the primal parts of the brain, a situation where it sort of escalates more than what it probably would be. And we see that happen a lot. Okay, there's been books written out there about these parts of the brain. There's plenty of books out there, the likes of Steve Peters and Dan Goleman. They've all written some good books out there around emotional intelligence, and the chimp paradox by Steve Peters is a good read if you get a chance to read it. And he talks about like feeding the chimp, for example, which is quite useful in that respect. First off, from that point of view, it's sort of worth considering that from the point of view of the fear response, there's a part of the brain there, the thalamus, gets all the information from the senses. See, hear, feel, okay? All the senses, taste, smell. Smell's the only one that has a pathway straight to the limbic system, by the way, which is why when you see these fragrance commercials, they're all raunchy and use Vologen and sex to sell, because the limbic system and smell is the only one that's got a direct pathway from that point of view. But from the point of view of the thalamus, it's getting information coming in, okay? And then what you're doing then is it's sending information on to the amygdala. Now, you've probably heard a lot about the amygdala these days. A lot been written about it. People say it's an almond shape. Well, that's true to a point, but there's more to it than that, structurally, which I can go into more detail in the course and send you information on that. It's not entirely true, just an almond shape. It's not entirely true that it's only a fear response. It has other functions too. But from this point of view, from a fear response point of view, the thalamus sends information to the amygdala, and the amygdala then is pre-screening, okay, the information, the hippocampus, from past experiences. Okay, so the baby, little Albert, the experiences of the loud noise going off. Okay, the smoke detector, the amygdala, the hippocampus, past dangerous events. Okay, conditioned learning. So the brain is implicit. You have an appraisal of a certain situation, and it's stored in the memory. Okay, what's fact? What's opinion? Okay. So, for example, as a 5-year-old. You got bitten by a dog, and then you see the same type of dog 30 years later in the park. What do you think your response might be? So you're screening that in the campus past events. It might not be because you've reappraised the situation, or it's not affecting you the same way. But like Margaret in the swimming pool, 8-year-old. Okay, swimming pool, danger, alarm bell goes off because of that experience that happened. Now, a lot of time, ironically enough, people don't even know. It's so deep into the unconscious, they don't even know what it is. I went with a woman one time, she was in the course, and she would go home from work. She told me on this course a while ago, every time she went home from work, she'd feel really panicky and anxious. Didn't know why. No idea why. She goes home from work. No idea why she felt anxious and wouldn't leave the house until the following morning to go to work. At work, she was fine. She told me how she felt. I regressed her to the earliest experience of that feeling. What she said is that she actually got attacked by a dog. And though she got attacked by, in her mind, had a similar bark to the dog that would bark next door when she got in. And she put two and two. Dog starts barking. It's not on the radar, because we know consciously we're going to be focused on so much information, 5 to 9 pieces of information at any given period of time. So it's not even on the radar, but it's sending the warning signal out there. So we go back in time. She has this realization. Was that true? I don't know. Because it's like looking for a needle in a haystack. We have so many experiences. In effect, we receive 12 million pieces of information to process every second. Every time I click my fingers, 1 second, 1 second, think about it, you're getting 12 billion pieces of information you've got to process from the outside world, not to mention what's inside your brain already. Okay, Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi said his book Flow was 2 million. Now we know it's 12. That's a lot to process. Brain's going to fry. So what the brain does, we know it filters information. And the filters we've got, values, beliefs, experiences, metaprogram, and so on and so forth, to a manageable level of 134. So if I'm giving you, say, if I'm passing you 12 million jelly babies, okay, if it's possible, it'd be pretty hard to hold them in your hand. Okay, you're going to be selective to what flavors you choose. But eventually it's going to fill the whole room. If I pass you 134 jelly babies, you're probably able to hold them in your hand and pass to the person next to you, okay, pretty easy enough to do that. But equally, you have a series of filters and you delete, you generalize this distorted information based on your own experiences. And distortion is quite useful. We have a health and safety officer in the group who would have distorted plenty of rooms, because if you don't distort the room, there's never been a fire in here, but there could be. So that's distortion, and that's where it works really well. You stop at a stop sign, that's distortion, because the permutation is what could happen if you don't stop, which is good. But it's also not good too, because distortion means that as a sports team, you see the team a lot bigger than what they are, a lot better than what they are. As an interviewer, you see the person who's going to interview as being a lot, you know, potentially bigger and harsher than what they are. So you can distort reality in a negative way. You go to present information, you see the group as being intimidating. So all these things are relevant in that sense, that we delete information. Because if you go to the shop at lunchtime, you're not going to tell them every blade of grass you will go, every ingredient in your sandwich that you buy. You're going to delete information, otherwise the brain will just take forever to explain one process. But what you delete is key. Okay, you generalize. Every day you get up in the morning and you sort of, you brush your teeth, you put your clothes, you make a little coffee, you drive. Okay, it's useful to generalize, but then we also stereotype, which is not always a good thing. Confirmation bias, perceptual bias, negativity bias. And these can be potential problems, because whilst generalization is useful and you're not relearning stuff every day, it's the part of the brain that can go into economy mode. Equally, in one respect, it can be unuseful too. And the brain likes a familiarity. Okay, the brain likes familiarity as well. It likes things to be familiar. The issue is the unfamiliar can become frightening too. Okay, so from this point of view, you're pre-screening. Okay, past situation. So what happened all those years ago, that schema, if you want to call it that, for want of a better word, is your own reality. Is the dog really dangerous? Well, it might be, but it might not be. Okay. If I said the word kitchen, you'd have an experience around that word. And the experience might be what you see, what you'd hear, what you'd smell, what you'd taste. But if I went to a place in the world that a tribe living in a jungle somewhere never had exposure to a kitchen, they wouldn't have the same schema as you have. But equally, we wouldn't have the schema as they had. Okay? So the person who has the dog, or similar dog, the dog's really loving towards that person, sees the dog, they'll be saying to you, why are you scared for? So if I come from a part of the world where spiders are dangerous and I'm told to look out for them, and I go to a part of the world where spiders are not known to be dangerous, a whole different perception of reality. Okay, who's right, who's wrong? What's fact, what's opinion? Okay, the amygdala activates the hypothalamus to trigger the fear response in the body. Okay, so we trigger the fear response in the body. Think about it this way. You see you hear someone walking behind you at night. You watch a scary film. Maybe you see a dog coming towards you. Okay? Maybe you're given some bad news at work. You've been told you've been made redundant. So all these things activates the hypothalamus to trigger a fear response in the body. What's it feel like when you experience that fear? The automatic reaction. Bam. The fear response. What happens, and what's really important to know, the amygdala deactivates the rational brain. You're not behaving rationally in a fear response. Ever seen those professional sports people, the footballers, when they got to take a penalty and they look like they can't coordinate themselves? They scored a goal in training 100 times out of 100, but in a big game, they look like they can't coordinate themselves. You're probably wondering why. Because their appraisal of the situation, it could be a cup final, and that's what's going through their mind. And the irony is that, you know, they're thinking, I'll probably never win one again, it's my only chance to win it. The pressure, but what is pressure anyway? It's what we put on ourselves. They don't go to process. They're thinking so much about the outcome. So the fear, and that could be at work. If someone, the boss comes to you and is putting a lot of stress, or you're putting your staff under stress to meet targets continuously. What you're doing in effect, whilst the targets have to be met, I'm being airy-fairy, wishy-washy here, by the way, to give them the best chance to do well. If you've got children, you've got exams coming up, and you keep telling them, if you don't get that A, you won't go to university, okay, you're not doing them any favours, because you're going to deactivate the part of the brain that's going to do the best chance they've got of passing the exam. So the reality is, we want to get them into a more flow state, in the state of absorption, in the state that they can do better to fulfill their potential. You got someone telling you, you know what, that doesn't happen, this will happen. Fear, okay, it's not going to work really well. So if we deactivate the rational brain, we deactivate the part of the brain that makes us who we are human beings, really. From one respect, there's some of the difference that we've got to animals is okay, we've got the capacity to think. As human beings, the reason we are where we are and have survived as long as we have is because we've got a part of the brain that animals don't have. Otherwise, we wouldn't survive a day. I assure you that. A lion would have us for breakfast. You know, all the animals, they have us on toast. We'd have no chance. We won't outswim a shark, won't fight a lion, okay? So we wouldn't last very long, but we think we can make tools, we can make shelter, we can get our basic needs met. Okay, so if you're deactivating that, you're not doing yourself favors. And imagine one moment, okay, think of a scenario now. Let's think of a scenario. Let's say there was something about the size of this, Y, okay, and on the other side of the room, it stretched the other side of the room, okay, it was about that wide, and you had to walk across it. It was only so high, and at the other side of the room, there was 1 million pounds. Would you feel confident enough to walk across to get your £1 million at the MSI? Yeah, you'd be okay, because you probably think it's not too far to fall. If you put this 10,000 meters in the sky, maybe not 10,000 meters, if we go, say, 1,000 meters level, where from an oxygen point of view, physiologically, you should be able to make it, would it make a difference? Would you feel as confident? No. Why? Because the permutations are different. But equally, all things being well, no strong wind up there and everything else, it's the same. But all of a sudden, the dynamic changes. Your appraisal changes. You're thinking, if I fall, I've got no chance. And even if you walked across it safely 100 times, you're probably still going to think, well, what if, what if, what if? The permutation is different. So from my point of view, it's all good and well telling someone didactically, trying to work out what's going through their mind, their thought process, looking for their ways of thinking. Are they thinking rational, irrational? But they've rationalized it. It makes sense to them. And the brain's going to do all it can to protect you and make you survive. The brain's going to do everything it can to safeguard you and keep you alive. From that point of view, the brain can't differentiate between reality and non-reality, but also we've got a survival instinct within us. The brain's going to do whatever, even if it means shutting that down. Okay? And then we become less effective. Okay? Glands release active chemicals called hormones, and they're active molecules which create emotions and moods. Okay? And the long and short of it is, the primary function of emotion is to trigger behaviors in response to the environment to increase the chances of survival. Okay? And when you bear in mind we inherit a negativity bias, because our primary goal is to keep the species alive and survival, when you bear in mind all those 100,000 years ago we had all these things roaming the earth, and you go back to primal times, human beings are storytelling creatures. We tell stories about ourselves and others. You go to a different town and you come back and tell the rest of the tribe the dangers of that town. You don't say there's nice countryside, nice beach. The first thing you report is the dangers. We've inherited that bias for survival. We don't have those dangers anymore, for the most part, in most civilizations. Okay, we don't have them. But we have got still that bias in the way we see and process information. And it causes us more problems than we need to have. That's not saying fear isn't a good thing, it's a useful thing to a point, but not if it's overwhelming you and causing you issues in that way. But we go back again in plain English, so you have an experience, whatever that experience is, and I'm so fast. Okay? So for example, let's say for example you are walking down the street at night time, you hear someone walk behind you, and you hear him walking. You hear their steps, you notice a shadow, all the information is being sent to the amygdala, and that's being screened. And even if you haven't had an experience before, you might have watched something on TV that's stuck in the unconscious mind about someone being attacked or something like that, or seen something in the news. Okay, even if there's been one attack in that place in the last 20 years, but you have something in the news, and it's sort of gone into your mind unconsciously. You screen for danger, activates hypothalamus for a true fear response. Your heart rate starts going faster. You start to the sweat glands, the cortisol, all things that happen when you're under fear. Deact the rational brain. So you start behaving erratically. Okay, and you go into states. Okay, and this can apply to most things. Okay. So for example, the situation could be doing a presentation. So the presentation, the thought about doing a presentation for somebody, okay, or presenting, and the information gets processed, the person can stand up in front of the group, they can think about it, okay, the thalamus sends the information to the amygdala, and let's say as a 12-year-old at school, they got told off by a teacher for not doing their homework, that the two get associated. And the very thought of doing a presentation, they just couldn't stand up and do it. They go back to type. And type meaning a point where they didn't have any skill in that area. Okay? The fear response in the body, the activates rational brain, and they just stand up and freeze. Run out of the room. Okay? You've seen it in sport, you've seen it in business, life in general. The primary function of the emotion is to trigger behaviors in response to the environment to increase our chances of survival. So we look at it that way, we start to think, well, the brain is not really designed to keep us happy. The brain is designed to keep us alive. You think about it that way. It's our job to consciously, to make a conscious effort to create experiences for ourselves from the point of view of how we feel emotionally, and also be more emotionally aware, to recognize your emotion, be aware, okay, of your emotion. If you've got children or you're a teacher or you're a coach, it might be worth telling your clients, or your staff, to be aware, be more aware of how you feel. So recognize how you feel. If you're a boss and you tell yourself, staff says, I feel afraid when I take a phone call, rather than sort of be Machiavellian and beat them down, say, let's talk about it. If you've got staff, if you're a football coach, you're a trainer, and the players say, well, I feel afraid. Let's talk about it. How do you feel? Okay. One time I was working at a professional club, and one of the players says to me, I feel really anxious. It's trying to tell you something. So accept it's there. Denial is not always a good thing. Okay, so let it come in. And accept it's there. As you accept it's there, you become more self-aware. Okay, the person with the widest range of awareness emotionally and the capacity to utilize emotions from a functional point of view will always have the biggest influence in this situation. The capacity, the flexibility, emotionally, will have the biggest influence. Because if you're a parent and you smoke when you're stressed, then your children will watch you probably do the same. Okay? If you've got an issue around emotional eating and you eat when you're stressed, then your children will probably do the same. If you're a teacher and you want your students to be motivated, then you probably want to go to motivation first. Observational learning. Okay, from that point of view. So the point of view here that I'm trying to make is that the young player says to me, I feel anxious. And it's okay to feel that way. So we normalize it. Your brain's working well. Accept it's there and investigate it. Let's talk it through. So I say to him, imagine the feeling being in front of you, symbolizing something, whatever that is. It might be an old teacher, it might be a parent, it might be a carer, it might be who knows? And let's sort of take the time to imagine the emotion being in front of you and talk to it. I'm not suggesting to do it at lunchtime on the street, probably get locked away, but the point being, be open with it. So the anxiety is there. What am I anxious about? What's happening? What's it telling me? Okay, what's going on? Okay, and you can open that dialogue. You can start to separate the thoughts from the emotion, the appraisal. And the young man saying, well, if I mess up, I'll never get the chance again. People watching me. What if I'm a failure? And all I can do now, I can see the words of the coach all those years ago in front of me telling me, you're never going to make it. You haven't got these qualities. Talk to the coach. And we fire questions. And how I respond to the coach, you're never going to make it. What's your response going to be? What's your response going to be to the fear? Externalize it. If you've got bad food in the fridge, it's going to put the other food off too. Take it out of the fridge. I talked earlier about connection, disconnection. He's connecting to that fear. He's piggybacking like Margaret in the swimming pool. The thought of swimming, so take it off and piggyback the new prospect, the excitement. Normalize it. It's good to be nervous because it means you care. Just channel it. It's okay to have butterflies, it's getting flying formation. Okay, so now we start to focus more on the excitement of the game, the opportunity that you have that most will never have. And the whole frame and appraisal changes. This too shall pass. It's going to fade away. Dissociate from the experience. And also work at an internal rep level too. Because here he's distorting it. Because we know external event comes in. So we know the external event comes in. We process it through our filters. Delete, distort, generalize. Language, memories, decisions, metaprogrammed values, beliefs, we know that. Then we have an internal representation, and his representation was the players were taller, he's going to miss a goal, they're going to laugh at him, the crowd's going to be laughing at him, he's going to walk off the field and say, you're rubbish, his coach will be in the crowd somewhere, his old coach from 10 years ago, laughing at him too. I told you to be afraid. So that's going on like those cartoons. You tell a rep. He's seeing all that. That's never happened before. So it might not happen anyway. There's a very good chance it won't happen. So we work at that level too. Change the images. You go to present and you see the people being 20 foot tall. The person interviewing you being 20 foot tall. So you change the images, the sounds, the feelings. We push them away, turn them down. Create a new image. The excitement of being applauded. The excitement of enjoying yourself. The feeling, the buzz. I said, what did you take football up for anyway, dude? Because I loved it. As a 12-year-old, I loved just playing. It was just absorption. I just loved playing. I dreamt of these situations. I said, well, get that 12-year-old back playing again. What did you see then? I saw the crowd. I saw the buzz. Okay, so that change, and that affects our states from the point of view of how we feel. The internal representation affects our states. So if you're sort of seeing people being bigger than what they are, saying you're rubbish, you're never going to make it, it's going to affect your state. If you see it differently, you're going to feel differently. Now, one of the quickest ways to change your state biochemically is use physiology. Because you know when someone's down, they don't sort of stand like that, do they? They kind of do that. And you know when someone is in it. So that's one thing we can use. So we looked at physiologically. So when you walk through the tunnel, you know, walk your back straight and look upright and just get to the state. Okay? Because at the output you have a behavior. Okay? So we sort of think about, and this is the NLP communication model, you think about, you know, you've got these 12 million information coming in every second from my finger, and you can only process 134 any given moment. Your brain would fry, and you have a process of deleting, distorting, generalized information and a series of filters that we talked about earlier. Then you have an internal representation. That impacts your state, that impacts your physiology, and your behavior. So the most important person you communicate is yourself, really. Because what's real and not real? Okay? What's real and not real? And from a point of view of conscience, our short-term memory, we can only process about 5 to 9 pieces of information. We're aware of that, +7, -2. Okay? Now, Miller, in his famous paper, talked about that. So you can focus on a lot of things. Like if this room is dark, you can focus on something negative over there with the torch or something positive there. Okay? And you know as a coach and manager, if you're giving people information from the point of view of chunks, they come in at half time, the sports people, they're already tired because of the game, fatigue, and you've got a manager and the coach giving them information. They can only process 3 to 5 pieces anyway, maybe 5 to 9, probably more like 3 or 4. So the instructions should be concise and clear, which is really important from that point of view, because they can't process. The same goes for most things, but from the point of view of ourselves, we can consciously make the effort to reappraise situations. Okay? Because you can break up in a relationship and your force might be, beliefs might be, I'll never meet anyone again. I'll be on my own. I'll be lost. And then that produces a series of images where you see yourself on your own, lonely, sad, down, and you get a feeling and you sort of go like that. The behavior, you withdraw from society completely. But equally, you might reappraise, think there's plenty of people in relationship that are lonely, and people not in relationship. That could be one appraisal. The appraisal might be, I'm going to create this opportunity now to do things that I didn't do before. The appraisal might be, actually, it brings me to meet the right person for me, whatever that might be. So you lose a job, the same thing applies. It's key to what you do behaviorally. Okay, I know we've only sort of brushed on this, we're going to go into more detail after lunchtime, but it's quite significant in one sense because we want to be more consciously aware. But also we can apply interventions at various levels as well. We can challenge our generalizations. We can be more aware of the distortions. We can notice what we're deleting. Be more aware of the language you use, yourself and others. Be able to reappraise memories. Understand the decisions. Our values and beliefs, be more aware of them. Okay, and what we value, what's important to us, why we value a situation. Our beliefs about ourselves, the future, others, the world, and internal reps, our states. Be more aware of that. Utilize processes to affect things in different areas. Be more aware of our behavior. Because the beautiful thing is that we can change the pattern. Okay? That's one of the most amazing things, I think, that we can actually change. We can interrupt whatever patterns. And a lot of people run these patterns from very early on in life. They don't change. Okay? The most predictable indicator of behavior is it tends to repeat itself. People just run the same pattern over and over again. Like a record. Okay? And it's quite ironic, really, because if you went home and you watched TV, you wouldn't watch a show you didn't like very much. You change the channel. You go in the car at lunchtime, or when the course is finished this afternoon for the day, you put the radio on, you change the radio until you find a tune you like, or you put a tune you like with MP3. You don't put a song that you don't like full blast. So be more aware is useful. Understanding that you are and have an element of control if you choose to. Break out of that autopilot. People say to me sometimes, because of my background in hypnosis, and they talk a lot about what we do in hypnosis, and they've got this misconception of what hypnosis is, and people talk about trance states and so on and so forth. People are in trance anyway, to a certain degree, throughout the day. They work on autopilot. People very rarely question anything, at least according to themselves. They run these patterns, these perceptions of reality. And for the most part, they're useful, but they can be really, really negative in terms of where we want to go, what we want to do. So your goal might be to pass an exam, to study, to write a book, to travel, to find a relationship, to do all these things. And what's getting in the way of you getting there is something that you could change. You could break that pattern if you choose to. You become more consciously aware of the situation, and think about it this way: neurons that fire together, wire together. Connections, mental activity, the brain structure change. So the more you practice fear, the more you practice sadness, anger, the better you get at it. The more you practice love, compassion, confidence, the better you get at it. Okay? Because they used to think that the brain wasn't malleable after a certain age. That was it. We know now that neuroplasticity, the brain can rewire itself. We know also that neurogenesis, okay, we produce new neurons. At one point they used to think that the cells in our brains are dying and we don't produce anything. But we know now that neurogenesis we do produce, and we produce them in the hippocampus, the memory region, for want of a better word, the brain. So creating your own experiences. And one thing to take away from all of these too, it's quite useful too, because the brain being malleable, that's why it's really important to learn new things and do things differently and keep challenging yourself. That's why it's important if you right-handed, do left-handed every now and again. If you walk to work one way, walk a different way. If you play sport, rugby, then pass the ball a different way. Do juggling, play an instrument. Do something new, learn something new all the time, because the brain is malleable. Okay, your brain is always changing. Okay, memories fade gradually, but the memory isn't as rich as the imagined memory because the finite neurons we have. So over time, we've got to make room for new memories. So creating experiences for yourself for changes too, being experiential is quite useful too. And remember that perception of events only what other people from their own point of view. So the course I'm doing now, I told the people I'm doing the course with, you'll have your own perception based on your own reality. We only perceive other people and events as we are from our own point of view, our own filters. Okay, those who are watching this, they're perceiving in their own reality, their own filters. Every one of us, so literally I'm doing a course by as many people as in the group and everybody else, individually rather than collectively, because it's our own. And I've talked about states, and I've talked about this on several occasions. For me, a lot of the work I've done in business is about states. Creating empowering states. So going in there and putting the KPIs to one side, external distribution, and going more internal. Getting people to think more internal, be more energetic, more motivated, more enthusiastic. Because you know the league table in sport, in rugby and football, will look after itself if you are functioning to the best of your ability. Because you can't control the referees. You can't control the weather. You can't control many aspects. And so why focus on them? In business, you can't control the KPI. You can affect them. The best way to affect them is to go to empowerment states. You're going to work as the victim down. And that's why as a manager, you've got responsibility to empower your staff. Because if your staff are disempowered, or you're a coach and disempowered, they won't function well. To take them here, in reverse to there. Because if you're here, you won't do really well. You're not going to achieve the KPI. You won't get anywhere near it, the league table. All we can do is all we can do. As a sporting team, you can only function to the best of your ability. In business, you can do the very best you can with your product. Okay, but going to this sort of empowering state. And the state for me, it can make a big difference. And very briefly on the final, before I break for lunch, to give you an example of how imperative this is. Many years ago, I get called and we're playing a cup game in football. And I use it, I know not everyone in the group is into sport, but we can all relate to this experience, I'm sure. And I get a call off manager saying, we've got a big game tomorrow. We're a much smaller team than the other team. They're much higher level than what we are. And we've got a big cup game. And he phones me up in the early hours of the morning saying, probably about midnight, a little bit after that, saying, well, I don't know what to do. Got some player suspensions, some players come down with flu. I can't believe this is happening to us. Why us? What a joke. What do we do? It's sod's law. He's getting to this sort of disempowering state. So what he's saying, to a certain extent, is true. We did have suspension, did have the flu in the team, the game had to go ahead. But equally, on the other hand, how good is it to everybody else if he walks in the dressing room next door like this? Oh, lads, big game. Probably not a great good deal. And I said, put the phone down, dude, and call me back in an hour. But 1 o'clock, just call me back in an hour. Okay, I'm the city that never sleeps. So he calls back in an hour, he says, you know what? We've got nothing to lose. The pressure's all on them. When they go out there, play the young players, they've got no fear. The young players are going to seize the moment. They're going to enjoy it. What a great chance it is. What a great chance it is for these players to go out there. How lucky they are to play against a team that's much higher. It's a showcase. We're going to enjoy it. This may never happen again. A bit different, isn't it? A bit different. Attitude's contagious. Is yours worth catching? Okay. So there's no point being the parent who says to the children, you know what, I don't think you should do this, but you do it. It's no good being the teacher saying to the students, you should all be motivated, but you're like, can't be asked. And there's no point being the leader of an organization. And so we've got to think of systems, by the way, that promote this, because it's not one size fits all. People ask me, how you did it? What do you do to do that? It's not one size fits all. But I know one thing's for sure. I know if the people I'm working with are enthusiastic, they're motivated, they're confident, they're robust, and if you could scale it 1 to 10, 10 being high, because it's hard to quantify, it's not like running a race, you run at a meter to take a time, you can get them at 9 and get them pumped up, we're going to punch above our weight. Because I can guarantee now 90% of society don't function anywhere near that. Okay? And I've been around people who've been successful for many years in sport and business, and I know a lot of them are no better than anybody else. They've got that capacity to turn on when they need. They can put their game head on. No matter what's going on around them, game head goes on. Okay? And that for me is imperative. And when we sort of cover all that. So that sort of takes us to lunch now. And after lunch, we'll sort of get